Edward Albee's Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf premiered on Broadway on October 13, 1962. Or we might say it erupted into Broadway. Culturally, the United States was only just coming out of the 50s, an era of conservatism and conformity. People were shocked by the viciousness of the characters in Albee's play. Howard Tobman, in his New York Times review, said that the play was possessed by raging demons and that its core was a bitter, keening lament. When the play was selected as the winner of the Pulitzer Prize the next year, the Pulitzer Board actually refused to award any prize rather than give it to Albee, in part because the criterion for the award at the time included that the play should, and I quote, represent in marked fashion the educational value and power of the stage. Come on, baby. Let's do the twist. But Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf isn't only a play about four people in a living room together. It's a play that, through a dense network of cultural references and symbols, exposes many of the anxieties that plagued upper-class white American culture in 1962, the year the play premiered and in which our production is set. In 1962, the United States was a country poised between the past and the future, torn between the technological marvels of the space race, the accompanying terrors of the Cold War, and the ongoing struggle for racial justice and civil rights for Black Americans. George and Martha, one of the couples at the center of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, were born in the 1910s. This means that by the time of the play, they've lived through two world wars, Prohibition, the Great Depression, the start of the Cold War, and some incredible technological advances. When they were children, the idea of a human pilot orbiting the planet was science fiction. In 1962, a US astronaut did just that, though not until the Soviet Union had done it first. The space race, after all, was a front in the Cold War, and everyone was keenly aware that those technologies had been developed in part as a byproduct of a nuclear arms race. Later in 1962, that arms race would nearly devolve into open warfare during the Cuban Missile Crisis. So, the future was uncertain, but the past seemed equally unreliable. The 50s had been the years of McCarthyism and the Red Scare. It was also the era that launched the mid-20th century civil rights movement. Suddenly, the idealized image of this country seemed questionable. Black activists pointed out, yet again, that this nation was founded on slavery, on oppression, on genocide, and that those systems remained in place. White Americans, of course, didn't always want to talk or think about this, particularly if they didn't live in the South, where many of them liked to imagine the problem was contained. So you'll notice that despite civil rights activists creating some of the most important events of the preceding decade, no one mentions this movement, or the violent white backlash against it, in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, which is set in a New England college town. Instead, George, Martha, Nick, and Honey start their evening with idle chit-chat after a faculty party. But as the night goes on, the veneer of genteel academic society begins to crack. And that fracture raises provocative questions for both its 1962 audience and for us today. What is it exactly that's bubbling to the surface of these conflicts? When you've built your existence on a fiction, what's left once it's revealed? And what does this mean for our potential to change, both in our society and ourselves?